Good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. I don't know if any of you heard what I've heard, but what I've heard about what teachers do best. Stay with my mind for a little bit. But what I've heard is teachers are the best at borrowing, begging, and stealing. anyone agree? So if we haven't done so yet, I'm sure you will do some of it soon when August comes around. I know I've had to do some, and Kelsey and I had to talk about it. We were laughing when I brought that up. But in our career, we know we use it quite often. And of course, it's to meet the needs for our students. So we're going to do what we need to do to get there. But today, we're going to present on something that will help prevent us from using things ours. So, less stealing, more of the appropriate way.
Appropriate stealing.
Yes. Borrowing. And it's called Open Educational Resources. So, I'm Rhea Francisco.
I'm Kelsey Dela Cruz.
And today we will present to you on Open Educational Resources. So, our learner outcomes is you'll learn what is OER, which is the abbreviation for Open Educational Resources, how it works, the importance of OER, the copyright, fair use, and OER, which we'll go over the definitions, and then the types of CC licenses and examples of OER.
Okay, so what is OER? OER, they're teaching and learning materials that you may use freely and reuse without any charge. And the importance of OER is, or how it works is, they are digital resources that you can find online. Usually people, educators use it in hybrid learning environments, so if you're doing both online and face-to-face lessons or activities. Through the PDISA digital content, resources are issued under a certain license, like what Rhea mentioned before. She mentioned CC, which means Creative Commons. And those, we're going to go over the types of CC licenses later in the presentation. And those licenses just determine how the materials can be, how the resources can be used. Because sometimes resources that you find that are OER, they can either only be copied and redistributed. You can't modify it, you can't revise it. And other times there are resources that you can modify and adapt it to whatever activities or lessons that you may have. You can find OERs in collections or repositories. So repositories are usually in like colleges, universities, like how UNG has a library database, or certain branches and departments of the federal government has repositories, the regular government has repositories, and in certain private institutions. OER can be used for formal and informal learning, and it is flexible and can be used in various ways that are appropriate for your learning activities. So just like with lessons and just how you would use certain assessments or activities, you can always tailor it to your students' learning needs, their grade level, their type of learning. And the OER also allows resources to adapt to the changes in academic disciplines and teaching methods. So we all know as educators that curriculum is always evolving throughout the years, they're always changing. So the good thing about OER resources is the flexibility allows them to evolve with the common educational trend or so why is OER important? So the three main points that I wanted to discuss today is because it provides educators and students with access to educational material, and especially being from an island, I know it's always hard for us to find resources, find certain materials for us to use to teach our students. So this is a good, alternative or good access point to get these materials. And it also introduces new alternatives for effective teaching. So some resources include lesson plans, assessments, even video tutorials, not just for students, but for teachers as well. I know this one example that I saw, it's a video tutorial on how to make learning place value more fun. So it's a place value game where, as opposed to just reading how the activity goes on Pinterest, the teacher actually sets up a video tutorial on how she actually goes about the moon, how she models it for you with her actual students and stuff like that. And also promotes collaboration and participation between educators. So I know we're used to working with our grade, within our grade level within our school, but now with open educational resources, we're able to work with different people from around the world. It can be from other islands, other states, and other countries. So I have a little video that talks more about the importance of open educational resources.
Education is fundamentally about sharing. Teachers share their knowledge and skills with students. Students share their questions and drafts with teachers. Those teachers share feedback, criticism, and encouragement with their students. And on it goes. In fact, if there's no sharing happening, there's no education happening. Education is shared, period. In the past, the only way for teachers to share with students outside their classrooms was to capture their knowledge and skills in physical artifacts like books. Unfortunately, for every additional person you hope to reach this way, you have to print another copy of the book and ship it somewhere around the world. It would be a terrifically expensive enterprise to try to reach even a tiny fraction of the world's learners this way. But the internet changes the equation. Instead of printing and shipping millions of physical books, a single digital resource like an electronic book can be copied and downloaded an infinite number of times at essentially no cost. The internet makes copying and distributing free. That means we can share on a scale unimagined in all of human history, which means we can educate like never before. Except that we can't. Well, not legally, anyway. You see, long before the internet was a gleam in an engineer's eye, copyright law began regulating the way we make and distribute copies of creative works like educational resources. Thus, the internet was born with a genetic defect that unmade its incredible ability to enable free copying and distributing. What the internet enabled, copyright already forbid. And this is precisely why open education is so important. Creators and authors of textbooks, research articles, and other educational materials can place an open license, like a Creative Commons license, on their works. The Creative Commons license tells everyone, hey, I'm giving you permission to reuse, revise, remix, and redistribute this material to everyone around the world. When a creator or author applies an open license to their educational materials, we call the result an open educational resource, or OER. OER are so critically important because they unlock the full technological power of the internet. Everything the internet enables, OER allows. And with open educational resources, for the first time in history, mankind has the potential to truly democratize access to education. And that is why open education matters.
So as you can see from the video, there's so many things that we can find online, there's so many materials that we can use, but how do we know we're using them, one, legally? How do we know we have permission to use them? So OER really helps. The resources that you find that are under OER makes it so much easier for us not to question ourselves or having to do any more research on materials, whether or not if it's open for anyone to use, or do you have permission, do you have to purchase it and whatnot. So that's why OER and education is really, really important. It saves us a lot of time. So now we're going to talk about copyright, fair use, and OER. We're just going to briefly go over the definitions of copyright and fair use, because I'm pretty sure you don't know really the definition. I know you've heard it before. So there's a difference between copyright, fair use, and open educational resources. So we're going to talk first about copyright. And copyright is any intellectual content, whether it be literature, music, any type of visual art. This content is automatically copyrighted when created, published, or reproduced. So for example, if Rhea was to write lyrics to a song, she automatically has copyrights and she has rights to those lyrics. No one can take it, no one can use it without her permission and stuff like that. So anything that anybody creates, they automatically have copyrights to. And fair use is a little bit different, especially for us educators, because with fair use, we do have rights, but they're limited. We have limited rights to using copyrighted material or works without consent per the U.S. copyrighted laws. but this doesn't necessarily turn content into open educational resources, because yes, we can use material that are copyrighted, however, we can only use it to a certain extent. So for example, if we're working on a thesis or if we're working on some sort of research paper, we can use quotes from an article, we can use quotes from a book, as long as we cite it properly. Or if we're critiquing something, that's considered fair use. So it does give us some rights, but it's not entirely OER. And public domain is intellectual content whose copyright has expired and can be used as an open educational resource. So these are things that did have copyright in the past, however, the time for it has expired. So this makes it open to the public for them to use. So this is a type of open educational resource. Works created by the federal government are considered open educational resources. And some governments include like the U.S. Census, Center for Disease and Control and Prevention, U.S. Bureau of Labor and Statistics. So these are some examples of places where you can get information or you can get documents from these branches or governments, and you can use them without any restrictions. So that's a type of OER. Institutionally licensed campus materials are also considered OER. And an example of this would be the databases at UOG. So if a student has, usually when you're enrolled in a university or a college, you have access to certain things. So you have access to the library databases or the archives. So this is an example of OER. And lastly, Creative Commons. They are openly licensed content that gives users permissions and conditions of use. So for the conditions of use part, there are six different types of CC licenses, and we're going to go over each of them soon. And we're going to talk about what are the certain conditions that these licenses hold.
Before we move into that, can some volunteers share some websites they go on to search some? Normally, I look for worksheets for my students. Any worksheets? Any websites that you want for worksheets?
TPT,
right? Some of us have to pay for that. Mm-hmm. Some of them are free. And that's something that when the maker provides it for us, that's why they allow it for the free portion. But then we pay to prevent us from copy doing anything to break the laws on the copyright. So that's why we end up having to pay some of them. Okay, any other websites?
Learning.com.
Some of them, I know I've done it. That's why after doing this presentation, I was like, oh, okay, now I know that. I can't not do it. Some of them we look at and we create our own. I've done that. Some of them we've downloaded or just copied and pasted the pictures. And that works, right? If it's clear enough, it works. So those are some things that I know, not only myself, but I've also run into other colleagues who do the same. And it's because we're trying to find ways to best assist our students. Of course, little did we know there's more to that than we did know.
It's kind of against the law.
Yes. So now, after going over the meanings of Creative Commons, which Kelsey will go into a little bit more, we're going to be able to keep a closer eye out on what we can and cannot be using and how to use them appropriately. So they are great go-tos, because they could have these licenses now that we're going to learn about them. They could have them there. It's just knowing what they are and being aware that there are such things. Because before all of this, I really didn't know. When Kelsey and I were talking about it, I was like, oh, that's good to know. And there's great resources, which we'll share towards the ending, that you can all go to and not have to do that anymore. And so the licenses that we're going to go over are the Creative Commons Attributes, the Creative Commons Attributes Non-Commercial, Share Alike Non-Commercial, Non-Derivative Non-Commercial.
So there's actually just three main types of licenses, but then there's two variations of the three. So the first one we're going to go over, Creative Commons Attributes, and this is pretty much content that you can copy, distribute, remix, revise, adapt, and build upon. So you can build upon the original work, or you can modify it as to however you want to revise it. And this is also, you can also use it for commercial purposes, as long as credit is given to the creator of the original content. And for the Creative Commons attribute, it's the most open license anyone can ever give for material. And for Creative Commons attributes non-commercial, it's the same concept. You can modify it, you can revise it, you can copy and distribute, however you can't use it for commercial purposes. So you can probably use it for yourself, you can use it for your customer, but it's not something that you can take and then use it to make something new and then go out and sell it onto TPT or give it to other districts or other schools. Okay. So, and then the share alike is almost the same. It's where you can copy, distribute, remix, revise, and build upon original work, even for commercial purposes, as long as credit is given to the creator of the original content. However, the difference is, for this, you can revise it, and you can copy and whatnot, but whatever new material you come up with using this content or resource, that your new material has to be under a share alike license as well. So you can't use a share alike license content and then make it Creative Commons attributes for all to use. So if you use this, it has to be the same license as whatever materials or content that you used. And this is the same concept again for the share alike non-commercial. You just can't use it for commercial purposes. And for non-derivative, this is where you can copy and distribute the original work, but you cannot modify it, you can't revise it, you can just copy it and you can share it. You can use it for commercial purposes as long as the credit is given to the original creator. And then non-derivative, non-commercial is where you can copy and distribute, but you cannot use it for commercial purposes. So one more time. Creative Commons attributes is where you can modify it, you can revise it, just give credit to the creator, and you can share it with whoever. Creative Commons non-commercial, same thing, you can modify it, revise it, but you can't use it for commercial purposes. Share alike is where you can modify and copy, but you have to make sure whatever you use it for, that material has to have a share alike license as well. You have to have the same type of license. And for the non-commercial, you can't use it for commercial purposes. And non-derivative is where you can copy and distribute, but you cannot modify. However, you can use it either for commercial purposes, or if you're going to use a non-commercial, it's for non-commercial purposes. And for the non-derivative, non-commercial, this is the most restrictive of the six open licenses. Okay, so is that able to soak in within that 2.5 minutes? Because we're going to have a little quiz with my friend Ryan. He says, hey girl, can I see your license? No need for registration. So anyway, so I'm going to give you a scenario, and then it's multiple choice. I'm going to give you a scenario, and you need to tell me whether or not that kind of material is a Creative Commons attribute, NC, share alike NC, or non-derivative NC. So the scenario is a lesson, or the type of content it is it's a lesson plan that can be modified by the teacher and can be shared with anyone, as long as you give credit. For all of these licenses, you must give credit to the creator. So what kind of license would this have if a lesson plan can be modified, it can be revised, and it can be shared with anybody? Is it non-derivative, Creative Commons attributes, non-derivative, non-commercial, or Creative Commons attributes, non-commercial?
B.
Be nice. It is? This is
B.
Does everybody agree?
Yes.
You're
I was listening, and you guys are great teachers.
Okay, so the next type of material is a video tutorial that can be copied, but you cannot modify it. and must give credit to the creator. Again, it's a tutorial that can be copied but not modified at all. And then volunteers. Does everyone agree that it's a non-derivative?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so it is D, you're correct.
Yay!
Last one. A resource that can be used in new works, however, the work must be under the same license as the original source. Dr. Cruz.
A share alike.
Share alike. Everyone agrees?
Yes.
Yay, you're correct. Wow, we know about the six different licenses of Creative Commons. Good job.
All right, so now, I said earlier, we're going to go into some examples. We're going to move into that now. Now, Kelsey and I had the opportunity to look into other sites that we can use, but we wanted to give you four sites that you probably can use right away. I know it's almost the end of summer, so we're probably getting into that prep mode. So maybe you might start looking into these more. So the four sites we have to share is Pixabay.com. And I can't share too much because we're going to actually do an activity where you guys are going to find out a little bit more. And Pixabay is a good site where we can find images. So we're going to have you try that out, and I won't share too much after that. OERcommons.com, it's a really good site for assisting us in lesson planning, classroom resources. So when you get into there, you're going to see what other things might be good for you in your classroom. The Internet Archive, I actually fell in love with this for this program. It had way more than I expected, but really many options. The one thing I did get to use is it gives you, you just sign in and it makes you borrow a full book. I didn't have to pay, I just needed to give them my email address and my password and that's it. So, but there's so many more options and you guys will get to explore that too. And this one was a little bit hard for me, Khan Academy. but the Khan Academy, Kelsey shared with me, and I was, when I went on and tried it out, I was really surprised too. It is focused on math. So when you go on there, you're going to see some great things that we might be able to use as well in our classroom to focus on the math subject area. So Pixabay, OER Commons, Internet Archive, and Khan Academy. All right, so this part is actually the part we're going to use our laptops for. So you can go ahead and open it up. And in your groups of two, so we kind of already paired you up, you already have your laptops ready. And we're going to just have you select one of the websites that we previously went over to check it out. And then, you can go ahead and type it in and start searching. And then she's going to pass out the worksheet you're going to need to fill out. All right, so in your group, you selected the website, and what you're going to do now is the worksheet gives us a guide on looking at what are the strengths, the improvements that need to be made in the website, and how you think you can use it to implement it in your classroom. What are some ways? And then we'll share as a group afterwards, give you about 10 minutes to go ahead and explore the website. And then we'll do a group discussion afterwards.
I love that you guys are being
that morning. Yes, absolutely. So we're
I'm guessing you guys have Pixabay.
I do. And I was like, I don't think it really is, when you make me go, my goals matter.
The department could excavate because pictures are.
Let me make sure.
No need to mention me.
I think I love to.
We're trying to figure out.
It's not like the, So maybe something that we. Right? But it's not as visually appealing as like. Oh, yes. So you just like save whatever you're like you're looking at, just like then you just save and it'll go near your
phone.
Like
that. Right.
And then like so practice like once
the
film has a spot and It also has some settings so you can conference, attend virtual lectures, view videos, and view other assessments that were pre-made by other teachers. some improvements. We said at first glance it looks really good. Maybe more step-by-step pictures for visual learners. And how can you apply this to this to your classroom as a tool for planning lessons?
Sounds great. Thank you for sharing.
Yes.
So we had Khan Academy, and there's different subjects, areas that you could do in Khan Academy, but we decided to do early math. And what we, the strengths were that incorporated a variety of modalities to meet the needs of different learners. For example, it always starts out with a video, and the video was very graphic. The pictures were like colorful, and then we kind of took them step by step. And then after the video, it went straight to practicing. So it provided for practice. It was self-correct. If students made a mistake, it allowed them to self-correct. And then, so that way they're not practicing the wrong way. So that was good. It incorporated motivational prompts, which we thought, so when a student got it correct, there was a star, great job. So it was motivating. Anything else for the strength?
Also to its being an equity, so pretty user friendly. And then improvements we are making, recommend incorporating pictorial representation of the problem.
So, right, yeah.
Since we did early math, kids tend to think in concrete first before you go
into abstract. So it kind of took kids from concrete to abstract, where it skipped pictorial. So it went from the video to, what's 4 plus 1? No pictures, nothing. So we thought that it skipped an important step, especially for early math. So we thought that it should have gone from the video to pictorial problems and then abstract problems. And how you can apply it in your classroom is, the video was a good introduction to math and technology, so it's nice that it incorporates technology. It can be used at the computer center or the computer lab for students to provide them with more practice, especially because it's self-correcting, and kids can practice independently. And then it also can be used for intervention for students who are still having difficulty with the skill.
Thank you so much.
So our OER was Pixabay, and one of the strengths that we found is that when you select a picture, or once you type in a searching for whatever it is you're looking for, once you selected the website, it gives you right away and indicates whether it's public domain and all the other copyright information, so there's no question as to whether or not you can legally save it or download it and use it. And one of the other things that we really appreciate as teachers, especially because there's so many things that we have to remember, that it did not ask us to create a sign-in, so we could just verify that we weren't like a robot with, typing in like a code, and then it automatically allowed us to download it. Because sometimes that was really frustrating as a teacher, you're trying to find some stuff and you have to sign in, do all this other stuff, and never remember that password ever again. And then the other thing that we thought was nice too is that, going back to what you guys were saying about leaning towards sharing among colleagues and all that, so it allowed you to share among many different social media domains. So you could do Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, the whole nine yards. So there was no limitation really to the share aspect. And of course, like we mentioned, it was immediately downloadable. And the other strength was, when you download it, you could select at what resolution you wanted to download it. So you could scale it down to be not so great if you just needed it really quick, and for something you didn't really need a high resolution, or you could scale it all the way up. And then one of the things we thought for the improvements, maybe partially because we're on the spot and we're trying to think of something to search for, but the search engine was really very specific. Like, you really had to know what you were looking for. So if we just typed in like education clip bar or something like that, it didn't really give us, came up with like 2 things, even though they have a whole category for education. So you really had to be specific and know exactly what you needed. So we kind of wish there was a little bit of laxity in that search engine. And then how we can apply it in our classroom, we were thinking probably the most used would be for newsletters, because it gives you a nice clip art to use. We could also, thinking like labor things in the classroom, because we have really cute, you know, like pencil things and, you know, so going from that concrete to abstract where they can't read yet, so we can have those pictorial representations of things in the class to where to get them. And then for decor, because you could print things out and use them on a bulletin board. And then the other one for lessons would be, they have a lot of nice photographs to have. So those could be used to show kids like photographs of animals and places that maybe they'll never be able to go to, like just to get that. Yeah, the
like the Four Seasons.
Yeah.
We had the Internet Archive. Some strengths are multiple options and resources to choose from. It's categorized, organized, visually appealing, easy navigation for teachers. It's really just teacher friendly. But for me, we didn't really have an improvement per se. Like what can we say if we just started using it? Yeah. But for an improvement, I think for first time visitors, maybe a tutorial. Because you don't know exactly how to navigate the entire thing. But if there's at least an option for a tutorial on the side, then at least you can click and get a gist of how to use it right away. Application for me was borrowing books for tablet use because we have audio. We have e-books, actual books. They also have clips, clip arts. They have videos also. Same.
Yeah. Sounds good. That was a good brief description of each of the websites, especially because, like Janine said, it takes a little time to really dig in. Kelsey and I only had a few minutes really to just try it out real quick and then just whatever we could share amongst each other before deciding do we really want to share this with all of you. And there is much more lists as you go on and search online. If you go on OER Commons, Creative Commons, you're going to find other websites that share bunches and bunches of different websites you can go on to, which is what we really liked when we were searching, and they gave us a better idea of what could work for us as educators, and then maybe what could work for your parents, because of course, even parents want to assist us in getting their kids where they need to be. So knowing what sites to go to will definitely help us better service our students.
So now we are at the end of our presentation, but before we conclude, we just wanted to go over our learning outcomes one more time.
Alright, so what we're going to use is the thumbs up, thumbs sideways, and thumbs down. So thumbs up, you've got a pretty good amount of information you think you can maybe even share with a friend, right? Thumbs sideways, you're still learning, but you're getting there. And of course, thumbs down, Kelsey and I were joking, we didn't send you the presentation and you can't go from this
yourself.
So up, sideways, down, how you feel on each of the learning outcomes.
So, your thumbs for if you know what OER is the meaning, the concept, nice. Do you know how OER works? Okay, awesome. Do you understand the importance of OER, like having open educational resources? Do you understand the meaning and the difference between copyright fair use and open educational resources? And the types of Creative Commons licenses.
I didn't know there were so many.
Yeah.
Six. And you have a understanding of the examples of the types of OERs that we presented, we shared today. Nice. Awesome. So before we conclude, we have handouts here for you. We have this, actually, we found on one of the Creative Commons sites, and it has a actually shows here what kind, so it has here, it actually shows the kind of license it has. This is a handle that we found on one of the Creative Commons websites, and it says that it is a Creative Commons attribute, non-commercial, so we can share it with you, but then we can't take it and share it with the rest of the world. But we can share it with you, so you guys have a copy of this. And we also created a handout that kind of summarizes our whole presentation of what is OER, the importance, how it works. And also we also included some examples of, or some websites where you can find so many types of OER resources and materials, especially the very first one. That's where we found all of our examples. And there's much more for us, especially in our profession, because we're all early childhood educators, or we work with young children, so we find a lot of examples and great sites on that as well. And so we'll pass this out, and that concludes our presentation.
Thank you.